Okay, the title of this talk is Brian Cox talking a load of nonsense about physics. Brian Cox is a popularizer of physics on television. I think he is also a professor that teaches physics students, and I am citing him as an example of how physicists can talk a load of nonsense about physics. He is actually saying what a typical physicist would say, so it's not just him. The whole of modern physics is a mess, and I'm going to lay the main blame at Einstein's feet. Einstein has been very influential, and he has set the dogma of these physicists to talk nonsense. Right then. So now to the details. The main video I will refer to is titled "Was Brian Cox Wrong?" At 60 symbols at that place, where it is actually physicists trying to defend what Brian Cox has said at this site, but still taking that into account, Brian Cox is still talking nonsense. Right, what Brian Cox has done, he has been very brave in trying to give a talk on television about quantum mechanics. It's a difficult subject, and Brian Cox tried to explain things as simply as possible without much maths, in a way that the largest number of people would understand. So it suffers from having to dumb things down so much that it becomes a distortion of what the physics really is. So this is a reaction to what Brian Cox has delivered in his lecture. In my last talk, The Lie on Which Einstein's Relativity is Built, in 2014, at that site, I pointed out that Neil deGrasse Tyson suffered from the same problem when he tried to explain Einstein's relativity as simply as possible. He tried to explain it so simply that the result was he was lying and deceiving the audience to the actual physics involved. So Brian Cox has done the same sort of thing. He's talked about quantum mechanics, and he has tried to simplify it so much, he is now basically lying and deceiving the audience to what the actual physics is involved. But also, Brian Cox is building upon the deception that Neil has built upon, and it leads him to basically lying about quantum mechanics. The Lie on Which Physicists Like Tyson Build Einstein's Relativity leads physicists like Cox to build lies in quantum mechanics. So the basic method they have is GIGO, which stands for garbage in, garbage out. It means that if invalid data is entered in a computer program, the resulting output will also be invalid. Definition at that place. Basically, the lie on which Einstein's relativity is based is the garbage in. It is invalid data and leads to garbage out. And then, with that garbage out, there is more garbage in. So there is a mountain of garbage, and that is modern physics. It staggers the ability of most people to comprehend so much garbage. A giant mountain of garbage is intimidating, but it is slowly built up. Garbage is added a piece at a time to the pile to create the garbage mountain. So, without further ado, let's go to this site where we can see them talk, dealing with "Was Brian Cox Wrong?" 60 symbols. Where is it? Right. This is the site. Was Brian Cox wrong? 60 symbols. And it refers to the issue. Brian Cox ruffled a few feathers with a TV lecture which touched upon the Pauli exclusion principle. Two of our 60 symbols regulars, Ed Copeland and Tony Padadilla, tried to explain what it was about. So it's a reaction to the criticism of Brian Cox's lecture. So Ed Copeland, Ed Copeland's homepage, he is Professor Ed Copeland from Sussex. He is a chair in physics and astronomy department. And Tony Padadilla, he is an associate professor of facility of science. And these are the people in this talk. So let's start it. We're going to have to jump through the adverts. Okay.
Managing Director of Think Drinks, and this is the story of how Vodafone One Express helped us grow our business.
Right, let's skip the advert.
There's been a bit of a reaction to a lecture Brian gave, which I'm a little bit surprised at. I saw the lecture, it was on BBC Two, so many millions of people saw it, and I thought it was fantastic, a night of the stars. I was amazed that he had the courage and then the ability to explain quantum mechanics quite like he did to the general public. And
this is the lecture with Brian Cox, which he's referring to, and Ed Copeland is saying how wonderful he thought the lecture was. But as you're going to find out, it's not very accurate.
It got quite technical at times.
I didn't watch it at the time, no. But since then, I've become aware that it's all kicked off, basically.
This is the question they raise. Did Brian Cox get it wrong? And this is a reaction to all the protests against Brian Cox's lecture. So they're trying to now defend what Brian Cox did.
It seems to me to have caused two reactions. One amongst the physicists, that's at a more technical level, and then one amongst a group of people who have jumped on some words that he used.
Some guys were posting, scientists were posting their, blogs on blogs were saying, this isn't right. Brian Cox himself was then responding to these blogs. It was all kicking off on Twitter.
He was talking about how everything in the universe, when you're dealing with quantum mechanics, how things are connected. And in particular, he was talking about electrons and the energy associated with electrons.
And it's been this sort of to and fro, and some of it quite nasty.
Right. He's saying this to and froing, some of it's quite nasty. And when you talk about physics, there is a profound belief among certain physicists to believe a certain thing, and if you criticise what they believe as being wrong, then they get rather nasty. It is, physics actually turns into almost a religious argument, where people have firmly fixed ideas based on a certain belief in physics, and they're no longer open then to considering the possibility they're wrong. Hence, it gets nasty.
On Twitter, on blogs, discussing the rights and wrongs of what Brian said.
He had this fantastic diamond which he'd managed to get hold of, worth £1 million, I think it was.
In this diamond, there are 3 million billion billion carbon atoms.
I don't have diamonds to play with, but he had a diamond, and he said, if I rub this diamond and I move the energy levels of the electrons within that diamond, and he said that because of Pauli's exclusion principle, that would cause the electrons far away, everywhere in the universe, to move a little bit as well.
Of all the electrons in the universe, must respect Pauli.
So let's pause here for a moment. This is where all the arguments have started because of what Brian Cox said about this. If you pick it, go back a little bit again, pick it up. This is the bit of the arguments about.
Cause the electrons far away, everywhere in the universe, to move a little bit as well.
Of all the electrons in the universe must respect Pauli. Therefore, every electron around every atom in the universe.
And he went.
So, this is where the arguments are starting, and now this is Copeland, I think, trying to excuse what Brian Cox has said.
In the universe.
And he went on to say that because of what's known as the Pauli exclusion principle, which says that no two electrons can ever be in the same quantum state, except he didn't use the word quantum state. That is the
important bit. Brian Cox, in his lecture, did not use the word quantum state. So he was inaccurate in what he was saying. And so Copeland is trying to say what Brian Cox should have said, and he's trying to cover up in that direction by his words. Let's pick it up again.
No two electrons can ever be in the same quantum state, except he didn't use the word quantum state, he used the word energy, and that's where the physicists have come in.
Sitting precisely this.
And that where the physicists come in is he used the word energy when he should have used the word quantum state. So what he was saying was inaccurate.
Same energy level.
Because they can't be in the same quantum state, therefore, if you move one electron up, and or a group of electrons, and change their energy, then the whole system throughout the universe will change as well.
It's not quite right what he said, no. But the spirit of what he said, it is okay.
Do you like the bluff there? He is admitting that what Brian Cox said was not quite accurate, but it was the spirit of the thing. Is the spirit of the thing good enough? Is it good enough to speak physics and not be accurate about what you're saying and just have this general idea of it? I mean, I don't think it's good enough myself, but he's trying to excuse it. He's got the spirit of the thing. It's not really accurate, but it's generally like that. Picking up again.
Right, what he said, no. But the spirit of what he said, it is okay.
He didn't draw an implication in the sense of saying anything controversial, it seems.
So, now, trying to excuse the mistake Brian Cox made in not using the correct words, this physicist Copeland is now trying to say that Brian Cox did not say anything controversial. But that's only if you are excusing the fact that he used his words wrong.
Implication in the sense of saying anything controversial, it seems to me. He just said, he's just pointing out. So other people have drawn the implications of it. They have inferred from it that means that, for example, one group of people are saying that accounts for the fact that we're all connected in our consciousness is all.
Now, this idea of we're all connected in our consciousness, that is seemed to be a new age way of looking at quantum physics. And what I understand is that these physicists don't really like that sort of way of looking at it. They don't approve of a new age way of looking at quantum physics, so they are prejudiced on that account, and this is where a lot of what they're going to say hinges upon. They're going to try to deny that the idea of consciousness is connected to what has been said. If Brian Cox had talked accurately about quantum physics, then an implication of what was being said would be the idea that all of consciousness is connected on a quantum physics sort of level. But these people don't really want to believe this. These Brian Cox and these physicists here. So they're trying to wiggle out of what things are implied.
They're saying that accounts for the fact that we're all connected in our consciousness is all connected, because when you change energy levels in one group, it immediately affects the energy levels in another group, and that link is real.
So everything is connected to everything else.
Because in quantum mechanics, you can't precisely say where something is at any given, or where it is and what its velocity is or momentum is. There's an uncertainty.
The uncertainty is what's called Heisenberg uncertainty, and what you start to notice is he's using a lot of hand signals, and really, to deal with this issue, you need to start doing the maths. You need to explain what you're talking about by putting some math equations up, and he's not doing that. Instead, all you're getting is a lot of hand waving.
You describe things in terms of wave functions, which give you probability of finding things. So the bigger the value of the wave function in a given region, the more likely it is that object is there. But these wave functions can spread, and they do spread, and the interconnectedness is simply the fact that all of the electrons, the wave function describing all of them, is spread across the universe. That's what quantum mechanics can do for you that classical mechanics can't. It can describe all of the particles with one wave function. That's what the idea is. And so it's not surprising to me that if you alter the state of an electron over here, and that it's going to have a knock-on effect somewhere else. Where all this...
So, there was a lot of hand-waving by Copeland, and it doesn't really mean anything as far as I'm concerned. It's just using vague words. If you're not going to explain the maths, then it's just vague words, a lot of hand waving, and it's not very impressive. And if he did actually do the maths, put the maths up to what he meant by words hand waving, I would then be started protesting about the maths being wrong in some way, that he was misrepresenting it. So you've either got him, a person like him, trying to simplify things by not doing any maths and just waving his hands. And so what he's talking about is just vague. It doesn't really mean anything. It's just mumble-jumble waffle. Or if he did the maths, then I and maybe other people would say, oh, we're complaining about that. We don't agree with what you're saying there about the maths. So he's got the choice of two things he can do there.
Here's the power of the exclusion principle. So this is the basic idea that no two fermions and electrons are fermions can occupy the same quantum state. Okay, now, I said something slightly different there to what Brian said. He said energy levels.
There you go. He admits he's saying something now different to what Brian Cox has said in the lecture. He's trying to cover up the mistake that Brian Cox had made about these words. Brian Cox used the wrong words. And now this physicist is trying to use what they think are the correct words. But still, even if you're using the correct words, it doesn't mean anything unless you explain what it connects to in the relevant maths. So it's a process of dumbing down a lot of jargon about words, and you've got to get dirty and do the maths. And they're trying to avoid that.
Quantum state. Okay, now, I said something slightly different there to what Brian said. He said energy levels, because you could maybe associate an energy level with one particular quantum number, but it doesn't necessarily describe the whole quantum state of that electron.
Well, I watched the lecture, and I thought it was a fantastic lecture, as I've said, and I do remember that last...
There you go. He's saying it's a fantastic lecture, despite Brian Cox making a mistake and not getting his facts right. Copeland is trying to defend Brian Cox. It's a fantastic lecture, even though it was not accurate. But that is, trying to cover up things.
Well, I watched the lecture, and I thought it was a fantastic lecture, as I've said. And I do remember that last bit of it, thinking, I've never thought about the interconnectedness of it, but it didn't cross my mind that there was anything untoward, that he was talking about things propagating faster than the speed of light or anything like that. It wasn't. But what has happened is, first of all, there's a group of people, as I said, have interpreted it as being an example of the fact that our consciousness is...
Yeah, there's a group of people who are interpreting quantum physics as our consciousnesses are all connected. And this is one of the issues in quantum physics. And I'll say I don't think they really approve of that interpretation. These physicists here don't really approve of that sort of New Age way of thinking about it. And now he's going to talk about the second group of people, the complaint from the second group of people.
Are all connected and we're in one beautiful universal universe, and which I think is just irrelevant here.
Use the word irrelevant, which is referring to the first group of people, the New Age sort of group of people. He's thinking their point of view is irrelevant. The second group,
which is more relevant, is that the physicists have picked up on the fact that Brian was using the exclusion principle, a fundamental principle in physics, and talking about it in terms of energy levels alone. Whereas the exclusion principle is a bit broader than that. It includes energy levels, but it includes other unique numbers, quantum numbers associated with the state of a particle. And so there's a technical argument or discussion that's been going on, and that's been going on at a really neat level, I think. Watching Twitter, the discussions that are going on, it's a high quality argument as they're talking about the various physical aspects. This isn't simple stuff.
Note the word, it is not simple stuff. So basically, Brian Cox tried to give a lecture on quantum mechanics, and this person there, physicist, is admitting it's not simple stuff, and basically it was dumbed down too much. Brian Cox tried to explain something simply as possible, and he'd dumbed things down too much. And when you dumb things down too much, it is a massive distortion of what actual physics is. If you believe the dumbed down version, you end up believing a lie. But they're trying to excuse that. They're trying to say, well, it's still a fantastic lecture, even though it was dumbed down too much to distort what's really being dealt with.
But it caused the other side of it, this thing about the consciousness, etc., I think so irritated Brian. I didn't see this bit of it. So
the first group of people are irritating Brian Cox. Brian Cox doesn't want to have the New Age interpretation of quantum mechanics. And I think these people here are trying to defend Brian Cox on that.
On the Twitter world. I don't have a Twitter account, but it so irritated him that he wrote an article for the Wall Street Journal in which he basically pointed out, you know, he was not implying that that this instantaneous effect of the electrons reacting to one another can be made use of.
There you go. So I unfortunately haven't read this Wall Street Journal. I think you've got to pay for it. So I don't. It is very sad that people can write nonsense, and then in order to see what that nonsense is, you've got to pay for it. But I think these physicists here, these two physicists, are going to deal with what Brian Cox is talking about, because it's all much the same basic idea of their way of looking at physics is much the same way as what Brian Cox is. So they're going to be dealing with a point of view of Brian Cox, which is wrong. These two people are going to be wrong. Brian Cox is going to be wrong.
In terms of sending information, you can't send any information faster than the speed of light. So you can't make use of this to actually say, I know exactly what that person's thinking.
So the point I want to make here is they're denying that you can send information faster than the speed of light. Now, as I'm going to get to, that does not really come from quantum mechanics. That is something which comes from Einstein's relativity, that belief. So we'll be getting to that.
Therefore, every electron around every atom in the universe must be shifting.
You know Brian Cox?
I know Brian, yeah, he's a good friend.
Has he stopped?
There you go. Brian Cox is a good friend. They're all friends. They're all friends together. They've all got the same point of view. They all believe in the same sort of thing. So now he's defending Brian Cox.
Has he done something wrong?
No, I don't think so. I think what's happened here is the physicists have got very excited and rightly started talking about the physics that he was describing.
Now he's admitting the physicists got excited and were right to actually get excited. And the problem was that Brian Cox was not talking about quantum physics properly. That's what they were getting excited about.
But the language that he used, we have to bear in mind, he was using on a television program, towards the end of a television program being broadcast to the general public. And so rather than talking, this is my interpretation, I haven't asked Brian, rather than deciding to talk about the quantum state, which would involve talking about the angular momentum and the magnetic moments and the spins, potentially you could talk...
I think that is a valid interpretation, that really, basically, what Brian Cox is trying to do is dumb things down. And his friend there, Copeland, is trying to excuse that. Brian Cox has given was brave to give a lecture on quantum mechanics, and trying to give a lecture on quantum mechanics, he found he had to dumb it down. And by dumbing it down, you totally distort it.
About the quantum state, which would involve talking about the angular momentum and the magnetic moments and the spins.
Potentially you could talk about the energy levels, the angular momentum, spin. There's a whole bunch of quantum numbers that you could include. And in fact, that's one of the key features of this, that there are a number of things that you could include to describe this this particle.
So none of the electrons in the universe can sit in precisely the same energy level.
He decided to concentrate on a concept that people are familiar with, which is energy. The idea that you can move from one energy level to another. That was...
So, to try to dumb it down, they concentrated on energy. I personally think they didn't deal with... Well, Brian Cox didn't deal with energy properly, and these people here talking now are not dealing with energy properly either. If you want to get into explaining energy, it's going to take a bit more than this. And it's going to take a bit more than Brian Cox's lecture. So dumbing it down, it's still not accurate enough.
...that people are familiar with, which is energy. The idea that you can move from one energy level to another. That was probably new enough for most of the audience. And so rather than describing the things in terms of quantum states, he concentrated on energies and said that you couldn't have things having exactly the same energy. And that's not necessarily the case with this Pauli exclusion principle, which he was making...
Note the words, and that's not necessarily the case with the Pauli exclusion principle. So what Brian Cox was saying is not necessarily the case. It's not necessarily the case with quantum mechanics, and... In other words, Brian Cox had got it wrong. I.e., Brian Cox had dumbed things down so much that Brian Cox was wrong. In other words, he was lying. Well, lying in my book. If you dumb things down so much that it distorts things so much and it's no longer accurate enough, then that is lying.
You can't have two fermions, indistinguishable fermions, in exactly the same quantum state. So they could have the same energy as long as some of the other numbers in the...
Notice that he's now using lots of technical words like fermions, and that needs a great deal of explanation.
Quantum state are different.
All the electrons across the universe instantly but imperceptibly change their energy levels. So everything is connected to everything else.
I mean, there is some interconnectedness, but this oversimplifies it.
Note the words, this oversimplifies, Brian Cox oversimplified things, and this person is admitting that Brian Cox oversimplified things. And by oversimplifying things, it is basically what you're saying is wrong. Go back again.
Anything else?
I mean, there is some interconnectedness, but this oversimplifies it, and I think that's what's got people's backs up. Like I said, so he's talking about energy levels there. I mean, saying you can't have two electrons in the same energy level, but that's not entirely true. We know that in a helium atom, two electrons occupy the lowest energy level. But the reason they can do that, the reason that doesn't violate Pauli's exclusion principle, is because they have different angular momentum.
He was picked up on that, and that then led into a more general discussion about the implications of all of this, of the fact that...
Note the hand waving.
You know, it is the case in quantum mechanics. When
no maths.
When something changes, maybe the energy of a system...
Just hand waving.
In this case, rubbing the carbon, and you change what's known as the Hamiltonian, which affects
Hamiltonian.
The energy of this system.
You need the maths for
changing
that.
Changing in the Hamiltonian affects all the other particles.
But you're not getting the maths, you're getting the hand
this
waving.
Property, which I mentioned, that in quantum mechanics, the wave function that describes all of the particles. So changing some over in one region will affect others in another region. But the key thing is that doesn't break causality. It doesn't mean that you can...
So basically, this person is trying to dumb things down too much in this talk he's giving. He's trying to oversimplify things. He's just going to do a lot of hand waving. He uses a lot of technical terms. And he's not going to get down to saying what the maths is. And if he got down to saying what the maths is, I would be complaining about that as well. So he's not winning with me as far as I'm concerned. But whether he convinces you. Whether these sort of physicists can convince you with a lot of hand waving, a lot of technical jargon. Well, that's your thing you've got to decide.
Send a signal over to your experimental friends in, say, the Andromeda galaxy, which they can make use of faster than light could have travelled. That's not possible.
Note the words he was saying, faster than light is not possible, and I'm going to dispute that anon. So...
make use of faster than light could have travelled. That's not possible.
Guilty of some oversimplification, I think.
He's talking about Brian Cox, and he's admitting that Brian Cox is guilty of some oversimplifications, and these two people here are actually doing the same thing. They are guilty of oversimplifications as well. They are defending Brian Cox, and they are being oversimplifying things. Note their smiling faces. They can tell you all this stuff, oversimplify what they're saying, distort what the actual physics is, and be happy about it. If you look at Brian Cox, he's the same sort of thing. He oversimplifies it, spoils away, and thinks, oh, I understand it.
Well, that's why he's on BBC Two and you're on 60 Symbols.
Yeah, you know, I personally, I think people should lay off a little bit. It's good that this is sparking a debate within science because of the end of it all.
Saying it's good it sparked a debate. Don't know why. Brian Cox ideally should have been accurate, but being accurate is a very difficult subject to present. So you basically can't win, Brian Cox. You either try to dumb it down for the audience, or you make it too complicated for the audience.
It's good that this is sparking a debate within science, because at the end of it all, we're all going to learn something, right? We're all going to learn, okay, Brian's made this point. It's got people interested in what he's talking about. And then people are starting to look a bit deeper and get to the real physics behind, I think, what he was trying to say, what he would have liked to have said, but which would never have been shown on BBC if he'd said it.
You're talking as if...
So, if we pick up on that, if Brian Cox had done a more accurate lecture, gone into the full complications of the subject, then... his friend here is saying that Brian Cox would probably not have been allowed to do the lecture at BBC. So he's trying to excuse Brian Cox by saying he wouldn't be allowed to do a proper lecture. So the dumbing down process of physics is allowed, because that's what the entertainment medium of television wants. They want, so it's not Brian Cox's fault, it's the entertainment medium wanting Brian Cox to dumb the subject down. I think that is a feeble excuse. It is, what we have is Brian Cox totally distorting the subject, and that is basically getting the subject wrong. And now the excuse is he had to do that. He had to do that. That's the only way he could present the programme, which is complete feeble nonsense. Go back again.
He was trying to say what he would have liked to have said, but which would never have been shown on BBC if he'd said it.
Ha 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 ha, laugh, laugh. Brian Cox is not allowed to do a proper lecture on quantum mechanics. He tried to do something which the entertainment medium would not let him do. Ho! Shows you how corrupt society is.
And get to the real physics behind, I think, what he was trying to say, what he would have liked to have said, but which would never have been shown on BBC if he'd said it.
You're talking as if it's all been a very collegiate debate and everything's been lovely, but the physicists have been a bit snipey too, haven't they?
Yeah, no, I mean, because they're quite passionate.
Note the word passionate. The physics community, physicists, are very passionate about what they believe. They believe some things, and they're very passionate in believing it. Ideally, science should be open to all possibilities, but really, you have people who are very passionate in believing what they want to believe. You have an example here of Brian Cox and his two friends here, Copeland and so forth. They are friends with Brian Cox, and they want to believe the same thing as Brian Cox, and so in a way they are passionate in what they want to believe about physics. It is a total distortion of physics. You've got a bigoted, biased point of view.
But the physicists have been a bit snipey too, haven't they?
Yeah, no, I mean, because they're quite passionate about the subject, but I don't think they have necessarily... I mean, they're now discussing it, right? I think that's probably a problem with Twitter as opposed to a problem with the physicists. Twitter has become this staggeringly powerful forum, but you're limited to, 140 characters or something. So you can't really describe Pauli's exclusion principle or what you really meant in a lecture in that kind of language.
More excuses for their friend Brian Cox. The difficulty of the medium is not allowing you to describe the physics accurately. So there's still a feeble excuse. Feeble. You should say on television or any other medium like Twitter, oh, I can't talk about this properly. You've got that option. But instead of doing that, they're prepared to make out they can dumb it down and still be accurate when really they've totally distorted the subject. Just a feeble excuse. Feeble excuse for people trying to cover up mistakes, their mistakes.
In that kind of in 140 characters, if you can, it's pretty impressive going.
Yeah, I mean, they do. It's quite normal for physicists to have fights with one another. I think that's how the scientific method works, so there's nothing wrong with that. Some of it's getting a bit snidey, and I think maybe there's a little bit of jealousy involved. But also, you know, it is important to get things right.
I think it's actually science working really well. And it's also...
He admitted just then that it's important to get things right, and they definitely didn't do that.
So a manifestation of how science itself is evolving, the way it's been communicated.
Maybe some of his responses to the Twitter comments might have been a little bit more considered, shall we say.
They've now actually effectively gone underground again, in the sense of probably gone back to original email, using emails and talking about it. But the initial discussion about this point was done in the open for everyone to see, and it's really interesting.
So that's the end of their little talk, and their little talk, I'm going to pick up now, the influence that Einstein's relativity has had on what they believe about quantum mechanics. And they brought up the issue of they didn't believe in faster-than-light communication of information. So this is a total distortion of their beliefs. And so all three of them, Brian Cox and his two friends on this lecture, Ed Copeland and Tony Padilla, have got totally false understanding of what the actual physics is. So I'll go back to my notes. So that's where we got to the Brian Cox was wrong bit. I made notes of all the comments they were making. So we can go on down to this one. See an article titled "Time Travel is Possible, but Only If You Want to Go into the Future and Not Come Back Again," says Brian Cox. Professor Brian Cox. So, I think I've got it here. There we go. This is "Time Travel is Possible, but Only If You Want to Go to the Future and Not Come Back," says Professor Brian Cox. They got a picture of him here. This is Brian Cox, and we've got a picture of Doctor Who, TARDIS, time machine. Right. Brian Cox made the claim at the British Science Festival. He explained time travel as already taking place, but on a very small scale. The closer someone travels to the speed of light, the more time slows. If time slows to a significant amount, it could transport the person thousands of years in the future. Right, so travelling through time may not be the far-fetched science fiction theory it once was thought to be, according to Professor Brian Cox. And so what we basically have here is Brian Cox believing in Einstein's relativity, and he is prepared to believe in some quite strange things about time travel and so forth. The wish weird things. Right. Go back to my note. You're prepared to believe some weird things. Now, back to my other lectures. As I pointed out in my lecture, which I titled "The Lie on Which Einstein's Relativity is Built," Einstein's relativity is built on a lie. And I've got another lecture where I'll explain there are revisions to relativity at that site. So if I can go to the first one. Copy. Paste and go. This is my lecture. The lie on which
most noted
Einstein's relativity is built. If I can find the place.
Fast. You always get the same measurement for the speed of light. That's assumption one, which, by the way, experiment has shown to be true.
And that is the lie. He's saying that experiment has shown this to be true. And as I point out in this lecture, go to it. There is a banned lecture by Sheldrake where he actually finds out. Sheldrake finds out they were not able to. Intellectual phase locking. Sheldrake points out in his lecture, which got banned, that they were not able to measure the speed of light as constant. So when Neil here says they did, he's lying. And if we go into the details of that, other people were involved in this sort of lie will then try to excuse the lie as a process of dumbing it down. Same sort of process that Brian Cox did with quantum mechanics. Brian Cox dumbed things down and got it wrong. Now Neil Tyson, he dumps things down about Einstein's relativity and gets things wrong. That's my thing. Now, my next talk is on revisions to relativity, and I'm not scared about getting onto the maths, and so I'm going to get onto the maths, the relevant maths of Einstein's relativity. Paste and go.
Along here.
See, oh, I got it there. I need to go back just a little bit. 24.33. So, this, I'm picking up the maths of which is used for Einstein's relativity. Right, play it on.
Issue of that mess, namely the derivation of time dilation. I will present the usual derivation of time dilation. Then look at it. Right, this is time dilation, and I'm quoting a site. This is standard time dilation derivation, where you have light bouncing up and down between two mirrors going a distance L, and when these mirrors move with the light bouncing up and down, then the light from that mirror goes in that direction, hits that mirror at the top, then bounces back down again. And by that time, the mirror has moved. This mirror moved here. So what we're forming from this is a Pythagorean triangle. If the velocity is v in that direction, then the distance travelled is vt. In time t, and we're taking the distance along here as being L. And this is an explanation of it as given at that website. A clock is made by sending a pulse of light towards a mirror at a distance L and back to a receiver. I think you get the general idea. So some notation, t is the time for light to reach the mirror in the lab for a clock at rest in rocket one. T dash is the time for light to reach the mirror in rocket one's rest frame. L is the distance to the mirror, that's the vertical distance. So the times and distances are related as follows. L equals C T prime. And then by Pythagorean theorem, we can form this. And Pythagorean theorem is the square of the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the squares on the other two sides. So if we go back, that's L squared plus V squared T squared, and that equals that distance squared. Simple Pythagorean theorem. So, eliminate L from the equations, just a bit of manipulation. And then we get T prime equal to T times this expression. And that is called the time dilation equation. That's how they derive time dilation. But now I want to look at the Pythagorean triangle again, which they're using. This hypotenuse is CT, the horizontal is VT, and the vertical is that. So the question becomes, why do they equate this to CT prime? If we were doing Newtonian physics, then we wouldn't have T different to T prime. We would instead have t as equal to t prime. And if we did that, we would have c prime is equal to the square root of c squared minus v squared. That equation.
In other words, see along there, V along there, along here, C prime. Okay, that this is the relevant maths. We point out in the maths. Along here, it's CT. Along here, it is the square root of C squared minus V squared times T. If we eliminate T from both sides, we've got the speed along here as C, and the speed along here as being square root of C squared minus V squared. So this speed of light along here is slower than the speed of light along here. So that's what you get, and based already on what's been pointed out, that Neil deGrasse, as an example of these physicists, they have lied about the experimental evidence. They have not got anything which disproves this. This is still a fact. The speed of light along here is slower than the speed of light along here. Speed of light is not constant. So that's how they build the lie up. It is not there are speeds faster than the speed of light. If we take this speed of light here, then this speed here is faster than this speed. So there are speeds faster than the speed of light. Right. Go back to my thing. So, that was the maths. I'm pointing out the speed C is a faster speed than that speed. And that is by Newtonian classical physics. Right. Now, quantum mechanics is built from classical physics. It does not have the speed restrictions placed on it by special relativity. If you want special relativity with quantum mechanics, then you've got to add it to quantum mechanics. And as I pointed out, special relativity is built on a lie. So now, I'm pointing at this person called Martin Reeves. Right, he's got an interesting book called Gravity's Fatal Attraction. There we go. I think I've got him here. Yeah, here we go. This is Martin Reeves. He's Astronomer Royal since 1995, Master of Trinity College, Cambridge, from 2004 to 2012, and President of the Royal Society. The important thing is he's a cosmologist and he's an astrophysicist. So I've got one of his books. Gravity's Fatal Attraction. And it's an interesting book. I won't say it's correct, but it's interesting. I'm going to quote, rather than keep quoting things all the time on the internet, I thought we'd make a change to bring up something from a book. Alright, here we go. The relevant thing is on page 260. You can see it there. And I'll just read it to you. Right. Starting from this is difficult. I'll just point this out here, I'll just have to read the book. Right then. Finding a unified theory that joins all types of forces is perhaps the most ambitious aim of physicists. Gravity is well described by Einstein's general theory of relativity, undoubtedly one of the great achievements of 20th century physics. So once again, he is saying how marvellous Einstein is. But Einstein's theory, like Newton's, is a classical theory. It does not incorporate the concepts of quantum theory, which revolutionised and deepened our understanding of atoms and forms the basis for modern descriptions of electromagnetism and other forces within atomic nuclei. A key tenet of quantum theory is Werner Heisenberg's famous uncertainty principle. The speed or energy of a particle cannot be pinned down instantaneously. The more precisely we wish to know these quantities, the longer the measurement takes. The lack of a fully quantized version of Einstein's theory hasn't impeded progress in astronomy. Gravity is so weak that it can be ignored on the scales of atoms and molecules, where quantum effects are important. Right, so what they've basically got is they have no unified theory combining properly Einstein's relativity with quantum physics, quantum mechanics. But people like Brian Cox are wanting to bring over things from their belief in Einstein's relativity into quantum mechanics. They can't unify general relativity to quantum mechanics, and therefore they can't unify special relativity to quantum mechanics, as far as I'm concerned. I would add, can't really add special relativity to quantum mechanics. That is a bluff by people like Brian Cox. So basically, he's bluffing. They cannot talk about physics properly because they do not have a unified theory that joins quantum and relativity. I don't have a problem with that myself because I have a unified theory which I'm going by, which is Boscovich. And if I bring up Boscovich again, maybe I show you. Boscovich. This is Boscovich. Boscovich is the 18th century, and he proposed a unified theory, which is the precursor of atomic theory, and he's made a lot of contributions to astronomy and so forth. That is a unified theory. I accept physics has gone wrong in the 20th century, and so I go back to when physics was unified. So I don't have a problem. It's modern physics going wrong. Go back. So, what they are doing is just hiding all the lies, more than just building on lies. Right, we get back. Revisions. So, point out the three people: Ed Copeland, Tony Padilla, Brian Cox, have all got their beliefs based upon Einstein's relativity, and they are bringing that baggage over into quantum mechanics. They haven't got a unified theory which properly combines relativity with quantum mechanics, and so they are then distorting quantum mechanics by making false claims. They're making false claims about faster than light speed communication. They've got it all wrong. They're not going by a unified theory. they're just making a botch of things. They have a mounting of lies, and they're just building on them. They try to excuse it as they do it, because it's a process of dumbing things down. So that's it for this time, thank you. Trying to get away with hand waving and dumbing things down, it's just not good enough. If they were trying to be more accurate in what they were saying, I would then be protesting about what they were saying, even on that. You keep building upon one lie, which is what Einstein's relativity is based upon. They're just carrying on building. Thank you.